So my name is Michael Brown. I am the lead technologist for our next generation chassis controller at Dell. Still getting used to saying Dell EMC. So you'll hear me still but just say Dell every once in a while. And what I'm here to talk to you today about is updating your Yocto environment and setting up strategies or setting up one method that we have used in my group to keep ourselves up to date and make it a little bit easier. So as I said, questions are important. Feel free to raise your hand anytime, ask a question. My job is to keep the thing going and end it on time, so I will keep it. I will cut things off if I am starting to go a little bit long. Let's see. So who am I? I've been at Dell, now Dell EMC, for 17 years, and I am the basically, you could say I'm the Yocto architect of the Yocto environment at Dell. So kind of a funny story how I got into that. I was on the Linux team for a very long time, and we had a couple of other folks on the embedded side that did a lot of evangelization around Open Embedded and Yocto. And anybody that ever came to me, I did a lot of containers, VMs, bootable ISOs, that kind of thing. Anybody came to me and mentioned the word embedded or anything not in x86, I said, go talk to Sean Hudson. Oh, by the way, he's here, he's presenting, he has a couple of BF sessions, he's a great guy, I recommend checking him out. But he worked at Dell, and then he decided to leave. 3 weeks later, I get a call from the director of the embedded team asking, can I come over and lead an effort to port away from our homegrown system and use some kind of standard base, which I had been advocating for several years, kind of pointing at Sean to do that. But that's how I became the Yocto guy. So currently working on all of our next generation stuff. I can't get into too much details about stuff that's not shipping, as you guys probably know about. But I can talk about the development process. So the problem. As we talked about a little bit before we started, this is about keeping your development environment up to date. It's not talking about device updates. There's several other sessions in this talk that talk about actual updating your device, and I recommend going to them. I'll probably be at a few of them. So, but as a prerequisite, before you update a device, you kind of have to build that updated component, and you have to test it out and get it all working before you can actually put it on a device. So that's what we're going to talk about today. Keeping your development updated is very hard. As we kind of saw at the show of hands before we started, the majority, I would say, of people in this room are using not current Yocto. A lot of reasons for that. One of the things is kind of inertia, fear of the unknown, and breakages. So when something breaks, if you break a development environment, you're putting, you know, teams of dozens, possibly hundreds of people kind of out of a job for a period of time until you can get that stuff fixed. So as you can imagine, if it happens once, happens twice, people get gun shy about updating their environment, and it happens pretty rarely. So going the other extreme, when you get a really out of date environment, we're shipping IoT devices that we talk about in this conference, shipping embedded, in my case, embedded server management. We're shipping stuff that's really old. And if you get a security vulnerability in one component, sometimes there's interlocking dependencies. If I want to update OpenSSL, well, I need a newer version of GCC, and you know, it goes on and on, and you get into this situation really quickly where you physically can't update to fix a security vulnerability. I did update a system, ported into Yocto 2 years ago. We were on a 2.4 kernel. So it can get kind of hairy trying to update stuff that's that old. So. I'm going to talk about that on the next slide. So I'm giving this talk to specifically talk about Yocto, but the concepts I'm going to talk about here can actually be applied on most systems. I have one slide, it's the big idea slide, that you can take that and kind of cookie cutter it. So Dell, we put what I'm going to talk about in this slide, we put this in place 2 years ago. With our next generation. So we've been in development for our next generation of server products for a couple of years now. And at the beginning of that process, we put this system in place. And we've used it to update through 4 major Yocto releases in our current head master development environment. So we've gotten this pretty much down. And have a benefits slide at the end. I need to save some material for that. so we've used this to keep ourselves up to date. I have to admit right now that we are certain right now sitting on 2.0 plus a little delta, because the guy that was heading up this project, he was a new college hire. We put him in charge of this, and because of the fact that he updated the environment, he got familiar with everything, and he became one of our go-to guys and became really valuable and got a big raise. And so do this stuff for career advancement. And he ended up getting pulled off of that to do other things because of the knowledge he gained directly from doing this. So this might seem like a drudgery type of thing, but from a career advancement perspective, it's a really quick way for a new guy to get familiar with your entire system. So the Dell EMC firmware team, specifically the people using Yocto, all of our embedded server management, so our IDRACs from our 12th generation onwards are all running Yoctos. The chassis management controller and all of our chassis, the M1000E, the Vertex, all the other chassis variants are all running on a Yocto base. And all of our in-development systems are all, for our next generation to be released, servers and chassis are all running on Yocto. Of note, we've actually come up with a nice little way to have one code base that we build all of these different products on, starting with our next generation stuff. It actually get more bang for our buck because we can update our Yocto base once and update several products. So the question was, how many developers you're talking about? Legal won't let me tell you, sorry. It's a large development team. So our Dell Yocto environment, we basically have Pokey plus Meta OE, which hopefully everybody in here kind of knows that. We have roughly 300 individual components that we use. And those are all individual standalone components, each with their own auto tools, with their own bit-bake recipes, et cetera. And basically I wrote almost all of the recipes, all the auto tools and everything. So any questions about that stuff, I can pretty much answer. So we have about 300 Git repositories to build all of our products. Managing that is a little bit challenging. I don't know why that's blue. Interesting. Anyway, it's not supposed to be highlighted. Export error. So we use the Android repo tool. When we started this back in 2012 is when we started the porting effort. And really we had Git submodules, which at that time I couldn't wrap my head around, and we had the repo tools. So the only real two tools we had to manage hundreds of repositories. So we chose repo tool and heavily based our environment around the repo tool to a lot of success. Today, there's other tools that can do equivalent things. So if you're starting out today, You can start with the Rebo tool. There's a couple other ones I heard about. It's names escape me at the moment. Stress from presenting, I think. So our environment is a full source build. So every component is all built from source. So every developer checks out and builds everything from source. So we leverage things like the Yocto state cache to speed that kind of thing up. From the way our tree works, we have, you check out at the top, we have the 14G. You create a directory to check your stuff out into. And we have a directory structure where we have Pokey, Meta OE. We have our own custom layer, MetaDRAC, where we have all of the Dell BitBake recipes. We have a policy in place, and this is a little thing that I highly recommend. We do not allow check-ins to our copy of the Pokey repository. So we always use straight, standard, out-of-the-box upstream Pokey. And then we do all our stuff as BB appends or writing our own classes. And then so all of our custom BB pens, all of our custom BitBake recipes are all in the MetaDRAC directory. External source, so I haven't really seen many people do it this way, but we check out all of our source tree, all of our Git trees under external source. This talk isn't about that, so I won't go into too much detail on it. But we leverage a custom written external source BB class that I wrote before the upstream Yocto got one. That lets us do our builds of our components inside of our Git repositories. And then our builds are separated out. Since we build several products from one source tree, you'll change your directory into one of the build subdirectories for the product that you're trying to build for and do a build. So this is kind of like the way the development environment is set up, and you'll kind of need to understand that to see the next part. Question. So the question is, copies of public repositories, do we copy? So internal to Dell, firewalls are a thing. So anything that we build, so like Pokey, Meta OE, we have our own internal mirror. And I treat those as if they are the public. And then we have a few repositories that we just mirror. And so there's like maybe a half a dozen to a dozen. So like the kernel, Pokey, Meta OE, and a few other things like that. Most of the other things that are external Git repositories use the standard Pokey, Git mirroring tarball, where you'll download a tarball of their source and plug it in. So I've cut out a lot of that stuff just for time. So branching, we have a naming convention we use for our branches. RHEL for release, slash 14G slash master is our current in development. And then we don't have any branches off that yet, but our other products that are already released would have a RHEL 14G 1.0, 1.1, and master branches. So we have a pretty hierarchical naming convention, so we can group all of our tags, group all of our branches, and you can easily see what's related to what. From a reusing, for example, with Pokey, we don't use master at all in any of our repositories because it conflicts with people's, if we're pulling in an upstream repository and using master, it's kind of hard. So I like to take their branch and pull it into our naming convention. So that's that step. So, the big idea. We have a separate build called Pokey Next. And you're like, okay, we came here for this? But it sounds really basic, but it's really the core of keeping yourself up to date. So the core requirements, and then the next slide I'll show you the kind of directory structure. We have a parallel build structure. So you can build all, and I pointed to the external source directory. So nobody in this room is shipping Yocto. People in this room, you're shipping your app. You have your code. You don't care about Yocto. You care about your app. So This is a parallel build where you build your code against either the upstream Pokey that you're running on or Pokey Next. And because we set this up so that you can do either or, you can get your code to run on both of them at the same time. This also means that there's no pressure that you have to have that, you know, I have to get this working within a week or 2 weeks, or you can update the Pokey Next, and if there's a bug with it, it's not stopping anybody from doing their work. They still have their normal Pokey. So small units of work. Once you get your code working against Pokey Next, you do dedicate one of your college hires to do updates of Pokey Next once every 3 weeks to 6 weeks is what we found kind of works. These are small incremental updates. You're basically just doing pulling in the baseline from upstream, and usually nothing will break. So if you do every 3 weeks, you do a git fetch, you know, and then push into your Pokey Next the new version, it'll just build. In our case, if upstream updates a version of a component, we might have to update a tarball because we can't access the external world. So the, you know, every 3 weeks involves pulling down a new tarball. In our case, this can work several different ways. The way we've done it, and the way I'm going to show you in the slides, is we have two separate source control repositories for Pokey and Pokey Next, and we control the flow of code between them. So the benefits of this is that you can work on the hard stuff. So a Yocto update breaks or is incompatible. Maybe there's a GCC update. You have to go fix a bunch of warnings or compile errors in your code. You can kind of do that in a way that works with the current Yocto release while making it forward compatible with the new Yocto release on your schedule. And when it's done, then you can switch over. So we're talking about parallel build structure. We actually have this .next directory, which will be hidden from normal developers doing an LS, so it doesn't confuse them. But we have another build directory under there, and so you can change directory to build/cmc under .next, and the BB layers are all set up to pull from these Yocto repositories, but the common code base. So we can do, developers can do a build against the next version of Yocto, or they can do a version of the currently working version of Yocto. So you have one guy that's just every few weeks, he does this update. He sends emails out to everybody who has new compiler warnings or new things that they need to fix in their code base in the Yocto Next, and then the development teams can schedule this. So show of hands, who's using Agile? Okay, so you know you have your sprint planning and your sprints, so the person doing the Yocto Next updates can then write stories or write defects against the code for Yocto Next, and then you can plan this out just like any other development task. It's not, the updates can tend to be unpredictable. You don't know what kind of work's gonna come your way. This kind of evens that out. So the Git repositories. Because we're using a repo tool and I like to keep all of the repositories we check out on one branch, the way we do it is we have a separate back-end Git repository for Pokey and Pokey Next. So we can continuously update this version with the upstream version. And then once you have this next version to your liking, which I'll talk about some branching and timelines, once you have this to your liking, you basically can just flip it into, so using a repo tool, you can just change a repository manifest to then point to this repository, or you can push code between the two repositories. It's kind of your choice. And repo tool, just the, and some people I've talked to, the repo tool seems really hard and difficult to use. It's actually fairly simple. You have an XML file. Here you can see we have a default revision. This is the branch that we're on. And then we have the Pokey directory, and we're pointing it at that idrac/pokey.git repository. And we have our .next repository. So this is just a small snippet of our actual manifest for illustration purposes. Oh, questions? So the question is, do we move PokeyNext to Pokey between releases or at release points, which is the next slide. I'll go over that in just a second. You had a question as well?
Yeah, at risk of making you repeat something, you said that sometimes in your mirroring, you also do that so that you can create branches with consistent names so that you can always do the single.
Yeah, so the way it works is internally we have a mirror, and that mirror, when you update that mirror, if you change anything on it, it completely blows it away and re-mirrors, right? So that upstream mirror has just what the Yocto project, git.yocto project has, all the, you know, Morty and Korgoth and all those funny names that I can never remember. In fact, I had to update the slide last night to be current and had to actually go to the Yocto project and look at the wiki to get the names. We have our own copy, and what you can do with Git is I can make a branch, and I can make my repository just have one branch and have it be just one branch from the source. So the Morty branch and all of its history in the upstream becomes my RHEL 14G master. And I have nothing else from that repository. And then I can update that using a git pull from my mirror or from upstream. And you know, from my developer's perspective, they don't see any difference. Answer your question? Okay. Let's go to the, so this is the kind of timelines we're talking about. So this is kind of like entry level, let's keep majorly up to date every 6 months type thing. We're going to go into a little bit more fine grain after we got this concept down. But what we have here is at the very bottom, we have our upstream Pokey. So there's, you know, hundreds of commits per day to upstream Pokey. We pull them in on a regular cadence, three weeks, 6 weeks, into our .next Pokey repository. So Yocto releases are 6 months long. And so for usually around 4 months or so of that, kind of ignore it mostly, do a few updates, make sure it works okay. But coming on that 4, 5, 6 month mark, when we're coming up on the release, we try to pick up the cadence on this so that we are kind of up to date with the upstream. A couple of cool, nice reasons for that. If we have a problem with something upstream is doing, we'll catch it and be able to submit a bug report and get it fixed before it gets set in stone. So this is one of the big reasons. And you know, every 6 months of work, this fits really well into an agile planning process. You can put stories in and you can kind of plan this out. And you know, from 2.1 to 2.2, you can't predict how many breakages you're gonna get. But you can kind of plan out the kind of work you'll do per sprint and kind of guesstimate on the number of breakages. And the more you do it, the smaller the breakages are going to be. So the more fine grain you get, the less work you'll do, and the better you'll be able to plan it. So then when 2.1 comes out, we update it. So a little delta, so you see the little jog in the line going up. We've updated our next repository. And then I cut out one slide for time, but that 2.1 up into the main repository, there's a lot of slack in there, and we can plan that basically around our release time frame. So we can do it immediately, or if there's something important, some important milestone where we need to do a release, we can say, okay, we'll wait, a month or so. So this is what gives us our flexibility on when we do our updates. Because that next Pokey directory is not going to go away. It's sitting there and it's buildable, and we have Jenkins jobs that build it, so we know that it's going to stay working. And once you get it working, it stays working. So that's the kind of a principle. It's not, if you got Jenkins jobs and you, I lied when I said it, when it works, it stays working, because developers will break it. But you can manage like one or two defects. If you have a Jenkins job that does a build once a day, then you can file a couple defects and get that stuff fixed in a timely manner. So the question is, are Jenkins jobs running automated tests? And I think my personal opinion is that should be the goal of everybody, is like you do a commit, it triggers a Jenkins job, puts it on hardware or an emulation, and those jobs. Automated build verification is what we call them, ABVT. In our world, we do have a build verification test suite that runs, for the NGM product I'm working on, we have a full QEMU instance set up. So, right in Jenkins, it fires up QEMU and starts running tests. And it's really great. We actually got a large amount of our code base up and running before we ever got hardware. And kind of amazed, cool tricks to amaze your management team. So this is your branching and merging. Let's see. So the nice thing about this, this is great for long-lived development projects. So for example, I said we started our next generation 2 years ago. And two years ago, I think 1.7, 1.8 was the current. And if without some kind of strategy for keeping that up to date, we would today be in our final development stages of still using 1.7 with all the bugs, and it's no longer under LT long-term support, et cetera. Looking at lots of revalidation effort to try to update it at the end of a development cycle, and who wants to do that? So smaller units of work means that you can start parceling this kind of work out to your junior developers. This is a great way, as I sent, kind of gave away at the beginning, the guys that you put on doing this, if they're any good at all, this is a really good way for them to jumpstart their knowledge of how everything interacts and interconnects. And they quickly become very valuable. But you can start it out by chunking little small things. You can write up, hey, run this git command, run this git command, run this build command, see what breaks. So it's something that junior guys can do, and it gets them up to speed. You get your control over when you get updates into production. So old way that I've seen, this is not a compare and contrast. I'm not trying to slam other methods of doing this. But one other way I've seen of doing this is people have their Pokey repository, and they just do a git update on it. And on somebody developer's checkout, and that developer hacks on it on his checkout until he gets everything working, and then commits it all. Well, the problem with that, lots of problems with that, you don't know how long it's going to take him to get it working with the next version. B, you don't know how extensively he tested all of that to make sure that everything is working the way it's supposed to before he checks it in. If it sits there, his code goes stale, and then he has to rebase all your code on top of changes that have went in. So it just becomes this kind of Red Queen's race to keep up to date on that updates checkout before you can check it in. So this lets you have control. Everything's checked into version control, and it's all parallel buildable. And then you can work with your project management team to schedule, hey, 2 weeks from now on Friday, we're moving Pokey Next into Pokey. From a political standpoint, when we put this in place, it was a lot of resistance. We have old-time embedded guys that just never wanted to update because they've been burned in the past and don't want to do it. So the very first time we did it, we had sign-offs from everybody. Everybody had to go into the .next directory, do a build, sign off that their team is okay with it. And we had a bunch of politics around that. After doing that four times, now it's, okay, Friday's the date, we're doing it. Speak now or forever hold your peace. And it's people are more comfortable with the idea now. So it's a kind of a steep learning curve, but once people get used to this idea, it becomes a lot easier. Jenkins, we talked about Jenkins. I highly recommend it. Whatever build system you have, if it's automated build system, is invaluable. We use Jenkins extensively. Okay, so wow, we're up to date with Pokey now. But we now ship the product, and now the product's in the customer's hands. And we just found out there's an OpenSSL vulnerability. Now what do we do? Okay, so we don't want to do a Yocto 2.2 to the master in development version. Let's apply the same exact concept, but now do it with a miner. And I call it, so we call it the .next and the .miner. So the .miner is for your shipping products, and you can do a 2.2.1 to 2.2.2 updates in using the same exact methodology. So you can get those updates in, do a quick build and test on them. Yocto product is, in so far from what I've seen, pretty good about not breaking stuff in those minor releases. So it's a quick build, verification, test, run it through all your automated builds, and then ship it. And then on top of that, some people in here are making products that you ship for 6 months and then it's never to be seen again. And that miner stuff is perfectly okay for that. But my team, we ship stuff we have to support for 5 years. So the long-term support for any Yocto release is shorter than 5 years. So we have to plan for a Yocto update in that lifetime of that system at some point. So we can combine these two for doing major Yocto updates on shipping products. So use .miner to do the small updates, and then you can kind of figure it out yourself. Do you want to do every Yocto, or do you want to skip a couple versions? It's keeping in mind the cost benefits of those. But now that you have those two concepts, you can combine them and figure out the best mix for yourself. Well, there's on any branch, so we've now done a release branch. So we have, and going back to a couple slides, RHEL 14G 1.0 master now. So in that 1.0 master, now there will be a Pokey and a Pokey minor, if it's a short thing, or a Pokey, Pokey minor, and Pokey next that is specific for that branch that we can rotate through. And the RHEL 14G master has its own Pokey copies. Do I have any special way of dealing with the pen files? So my main one that I came up with really early on is never, ever, ever check in the Pokey or Meta OE. And we do everything via BBPend. And luckily, 99% of the stuff we can do, we put in our own meta-drac directory and use BBPends for, and it works just fine. So since I put that policy of not checking in the Pokey in place at the beginning of this in 2012, after having a big blow up because somebody checked in without my knowledge, we did an update of Pokey that lost their changes, reverted a bunch of stuff, big mess. So now that we have this system in place, it's conceivable that you could check into Pokey and rebase those changes on top of newer versions. It can get a little complex though, and unless you have a Git expert, I don't recommend it. But the main thing is in our MetaDRAC, we have our BBAppend files. All the open source BBAppends are in one spot. So we have a MetaDRAC recipes OSS, and then a directory for each one. So it's in one spot where we can find them. So if you're, so that's the other problem about Yocto is you have all these layers. Finding out who modified what where, it can be a little bit challenging. So on our side, we do our part to keep it all centralized. So if you have a BB append for a Yocto or a Meta OE, it's all under one directory, a run directory structure, not everything in one directory. So. So branching and the overview for branching for miner, it's the same thing as for the next, except it's more frequent. So the, in this case, let's cut the slide out where we combine the whole thing. But the Poke upstream is at top. And here we do an as needed merge down in the dot miner Poke. And then here you can do merges into your main shipping Poke directory several times during a release on an as needed basis. So obviously if there's no changes going into your miner Poke, then there's no need for you to do a bunch of work there. So this is more of an as needed basis for your shipping products. And basically, I don't know if you probably can't read it, sorry. The flow chart is pull changes from upstream Poke, integrate into miner and build. Are there build issues? Fix them if there are. Do your build verification test. Does it pass? If not, fix them. And then once you've got all that stuff, you push it to your mainline Poke. This whole process, it takes like a day. So you, if you have the aforementioned, you know, really good college hire, they can do this kind of thing in a day for one update, a minor update. Minor updates are usually no problem. So that's the end of my slides. Have 15 minutes left, and I have a quick, very basic demo, nothing elaborate, that I wanted to walk through with you guys. Does anybody have any questions on this before I start to do a demo? Yeah, so the question was, you have to bite the bullet to get from your 1.3 Yocto up to Morty before you can do this. And the answer to that is yes, you can put this branching strategy in place so you have your existing code base all working with your existing, you know, 1.old version of Yocto. And then you can pull a Poke next and attempt to get it working. I myself did our 12G and 13G where servers were running Yocto 1.3. And then when we started 14G development, it was 1.6. And I actually did a 1.5 prototype before that. So I went from 1.3 to 1.6. The things were deprecated in BitBake and you had to go do a bunch of stuff. It was a big PITA. So yes, you do have to figured out that first step. Once you've done that first one, then it becomes much easier. Yes. So, what you said, bits and pieces are easier than that big hit. So, the first part is just getting your organization, your managers, your leads to sign up on this concept that we're going to keep ourselves up to date. And put whatever rigmarole or processes in place for that first to make sure everybody's comfortable. We had a whole process with sign-offs. I took a couple of those slides from the initial deck we put together 2 years ago to get this sold. And we had a whole process flow and sign-offs from teams and stuff like that. Be accommodating, except you're already up to date. But everybody else, be as accommodating as you can to get that initial update, but once you've got that initial update, subsequent updates become easier and easier to do. So we had another question?
Yeah, just a quick question. Sometimes in an initial Yocto build, when you're doing all those downloads, sometimes the downloads take time, sometimes the repos that are involved are offline temporarily. Do you do anything to try to cache or mirror
Yeah, I had another proposal for a talk of how we'd structure all of that, but that wasn't accepted. This one was. But the basic, so the question was, do we do anything, cache any of those downloads, et cetera? So we use BB underscore node network, or BB network equals zero. I forget what the exact variable is, but you set this bitbeg variable to say don't talk to the network at all under any circumstances, and that's set for all of our builds. And we have a separate Git repository called sources that we place all of the tarballs that we've downloaded that are needed for that build in that Git repository. So there's a archive format for all the upstream Git repositories that you can do. It takes a couple of times to do it to figure out how to tar it up properly, name it, but once you've done that, it's straightforward. Everything goes into that repository. It's a couple of gigabytes of a repository. So we don't keep, well, we keep version history, but we rotate that repository. So we have, for every release, we have a source repository and get a new one for every release. So that, because otherwise the repository history just explodes. That's basically how we do it. And then we have one or two developers who have proxies set up to go and update that as necessary. Yeah, so two answers to that. So at an overall level, yes, there's a BB underscore no underscore network equals one. You set that in your local.conf, and it completely disables. And then there's also another one called... Yeah, you can also say BB premier only, I think, is the other variable, where it will look for, you can have it set up a local mirror to get stuff from. You did say something that triggered me to say one thing. I forget exactly how you worded it, but how you set up your recipe matters. You need to have if you have any recipes that point to an external Git repository, you have to have a source rev and the actual hash of the rev in there. If you have it as a branch, it's gonna try to check that every single time it builds. So in your recipe, for anything that's pointing at a Git repository as the source, make sure you have source rev. And all of the Pokey and Meta OE all have that. It's just if you have your own recipes that point to random stuff, make sure you have a source rev or it won't work, it'll break. Yeah, so the question is, what is the time period it takes for this to happen? My example was one day for the miners. I just have to emphasize, the smaller updates you do, the faster it is. The longer you wait between them, it gets a little bit inconsistent because, you know, if there was a GCC upgrade that went into upstream in that time period, you might be looking at a lot more work. However, the system itself works. If you have the branches set up, if you run out of developer time, or in our case, our developer got pulled off to do other things, it'll sit there and it'll be waiting for you to come back and do it right. So this is gonna scale with the size of your team. I have a pretty large team and we can have one person dedicate, you know, basically a couple of days every 3 weeks to do this. On a smaller team, I can see how that it might be a little bit harder. At that point, it becomes more of a team effort. Hey, it's your turn to do it this time, and then rotate it around. Again, this is a really great way to become proficient at Yocto fast. So rotating this responsibility around a small team would probably be a great way of doing that. Our build host.
Start from scratch, what kind of hardware are you running on?
Okay, so what is our build environment run on? So I'm the one that set up all of our initial builds, all our initial Jenkins jobs and all that stuff, but we actually have a dedicated team that I turned all that over. And eventually they're gonna figure out that I still have admin access and take that away. But so we have, we are a computer company and we have the biggest piece of iron that you can imagine on this. We have like a machine of like 144 cores, some like a couple dozen build workers in Jenkins, and they also do some, this is an aside, but VMs don't work. We had our whole development environment based on developers having VMs that they did their work in, and it's complete and utter crap. Do not use VMs for this, use real hardware. Qualified assignment? We own. Okay, so it's slow. It was, no matter how much resources you gave a VM for a developer to do their build, it was 10, it took 1/10 the time to do a build on real hardware than it did on our best VM. So I'm a developer just running bitbake, a no-op bitbake command, it took 10 times as long. And so on my real hardware, I could do a build. So we actually have some shared infrastructure now for real hardware. Developers have logins to a couple of beast machines. And we do builds that take 20 minutes on that machine. And on our VM, it was taken like 3 hours to do a from scratch, no cached build. So, okay, I'll qualify that statement. Some people can have success with VMs. We had some really smart people dedicated to doing VMs, and they could never get it to be as good as hardware. And I saw a lot of head shaking here, so seems to be a sentiment. So if you want to know how to make VMs run really well, go talk to that guy. Might have run out of time for my demo. I have 5 minutes to do this demo, and it's a 5-minute demo, okay? So, oh my gosh, that's not gonna work. Let's fix the font size, I guess. Okay, what's the increased font size hotkey?
Command plus.
Thank you. That's not great, but it's better. Usually do this on my Linux box, sorry. Let's see. Okay. I just got to reset some work that I. Okay. Okay, so just to give an idea of setting up these mirrors, just did a quick, and sorry, I didn't ask. Can everybody see this relatively okay? Okay. So we have a mirror internal for conference purposes because Wi-Fi sucks. I have my own little copy of Pokey. So I'm basically going to set up a tree where I have a Pokey and a Pokey Next. I'm going to call them Pokey Krogoth and Pokey Morty. So we have our upstream copy here, and we have a bare repository here, and then another bare repository, and then I'm creating a checkout of the Pokey, and then I'm going to push. I'm pushing the Krogoth branch, in the upstream Pokey into RHEL 14G master of my bare repository. So my bare repository now has just that one branch. And then do the same thing for with Morty. So I call it Pokey and Pokey Next. The backend repositories, I just named them after the release. So Pokey Krogoth, Pokey Morty. So we're going to just switch the pointer of which repository we point at, because between the branches and Pokey, you can't pull between them. So that's that. So I have a repository, a repo, and I'll show you the manifest in a second, but I have a manifest that just checks out those two Pokey repositories. And I'll show you what that looks like after it finishes checking out. So this is my manifest. Here we have revision. We're checking out RHEL 14G master and Pokey Krogoth and Pokey Morty. So this get checked out into the Pokey directory and the .next Pokey respectively. And I have 1 minute, so just take me at word a couple. I can CD into this repository. And you can see here I have .next directory. It'll have Pokey and Pokey in it. I could do git log in both those directories and show you that they're the different branches. But I'm not going to do that for time. I'm going to switch the manifest to now, let's say we got everything done the way we want it to. And now in the manifest, I'm going to switch Pokey over to Morty. And then I'm going to check that in. Oops. And so now if I go back into my repo and I do a repo sync, you'll see that it's switching my Pokey Krogoth over to Pokey Morty. So you'll have to use your imagination for the rest of this, but it's all fairly straightforward. And like I said, works for us. I think that's the end of my time. Thank you guys.